Under Pressure with Dan and Guy is brought to you by
All American Canners and Pressure Cookers.
At the Fitzgerald Camp, there's always fresh meat. Right here, we got a fresh deer shoulder. Getting ready to take some of that off of there. What we're gonna do, we're just gonna start taking some of this meat off this shoulder. This is a good clean shoulder. You go find that knuckle, go right down till you touch the bone, and follow that bone down. Come up, and come up. You got yourself a good piece of meat right there. Okay, what we're gonna do, we're just gonna cut this up in chunks. You wanna take as much of this tallow as you can off this wild game. But the difference in cooking and canning, if you have that tallow in there, the only problem you have is it rises to the top and it can get in your, around your rubber ring on your lid, and it can break your seal. But if you don't have too much of it, that's not gonna happen. But when you try to cook venison with fat on it, it's rancid. It sticks to the roof of your mouth. When you do it in a pressure canner, cooker canner, it breaks it down. So it's not like that. It's just liquid. We got the shoulder cut up. Bring it to a boil and just do it enough to make a broth. We don't put any salt and pepper or anything in it right now. We just put it in there, and when this meat starts turning a little bit white, which when you see canned meat and it's got a white tint to it, that's what's happening. That's how it was done. You can see this meat is, it's still got color, and it's just about perfect. We've made our broth, and it's just starting to cook a little bit, and it's perfect to put in the jars. We got hot jars, we got hot meat, and I tell you what, I ain't gonna say this will make you wanna slap your mama, grandma, any of that kind of stuff, because that's kind of disrespectful, and we don't do that, but I gotta tell you, it'll make you wanna slap somebody. The only thing we put in these jars of anything, the beans and meat or anything, is just canning salt. We don't put any marinades, we don't put any of that kind of stuff in there. And on a pint, you want to use a half a teaspoon, which is right here. Just put a half a teaspoon on top. You don't even have to do this, but it will maintain the flavor. You can buy broth in the store, but we use, this is what we like to use, our natural broth that we've created right here. You want to allow 1 inch of headspace. Some things, a half inch of headspace is good. This meat and beans, we like a 1 inch of headspace, because you're going to have some fats rising to the top of this. Okay, we got our salt in. We've already checked our jars. There's no problem with those. Go around them with that vinegar. You really want to do it for sure when you're canning meat, because there is fat content in that meat, and it'll rise up and it can get under that rubber. But when you use this vinegar, it really seals it, so that can't happen. Put our lids on. Get 3 rings. Put your finger on there. Take it down. That's another thing we really like about the All American Canner. You know, this right here, or you can go to the 930, which holds 19 pints and 14 quarts. So you can put 2 layers of whatever you want on top of that and do it all at once. Second layer. Put your thing in there. Set that in there the same way. Keep it balanced. Put one on each side for now. Put it in here.
Filling it up.
Again, the All American Canner is made big enough that this stuff doesn't fit tight in there. And being able to put 2 layers is awesome. But I just like to take petroleum jelly. The All-American Canner is made metal to metal. There's no rubber gasket. The one that I grew up on, you had to replace that rubber gasket sometimes twice in a season. You got a mark here, and you got an arrow here. You want to set this thing in there. Since it's metal to metal, there's no O-rings or no bands or anything. So you want to set this in here with the arrow just slightly to the right of that. And you can see there's dog ears, right? These dogs will catch that to lock it down. But you set it down very, very gently. And you see how I'm rocking it back and forth to make sure it's level. You put that in there like that. And you twist it. And those dogs go in under there. You can see that. And they actually latch. Then what you do is you want to look at this under here. You might want to bring that camera down to do this guy. You look and make sure that you got the exact same amount of space all the way around this thing, and that tells you that this is level. Then what you do is just bring these wing nuts up.
Go crossways.
Yeah. You make sure you do two at a time,
yeah,
and make
sure. One, two, three, four like that. Do one.
Right. Always do them crossways. And what you do is just barely snug them up. Because you want to make sure you're leveling this thing as you go. What we do, bring them up till they're level. Then you go back and start over again and just finger tight like that. You don't want to use pliers. You don't want to use any of that stuff. You just want to do them finger tight. Now what we do is we wait until it builds steam. And it'll come up through the exhaust, the pressure relief. And it'll actually start a steady stream of steam coming out of that. We're going to wait till that happens. And then once it starts a steady stream, we want it to steam for 10 minutes to make sure that we got all the steam under control. So we're just going to wait right now until we get a steady stream of steam.
And what is your stove setting on, low, medium, or high?
Well, you have to learn your stove. And you'll have to do that as you go. And if you have to take notes, I do take notes. And you'll see what I'm saying as we go. I take stickies and make notes all over the place. But on this particular stove, I leave it on high until it starts steaming. And then I turn it down to medium. And it'll just about automatically go to 10 pounds. And we're going to talk about that. On this, we're going to actually process. It's called process time. We're going to actually process the meat and the beans for 75 minutes. That's an hour and 15 minutes, if you want to know what that is. Hour and 15 minutes from the time that we have we make sure our steam is consistent. Then the processing time doesn't start until you get your gauge to 10 pounds. And we'll talk about that when that time comes. Okay, this thing is steaming now, a steady stream. You want to make sure that it's a steady stream before you start counting. And once it's a steady stream like this, you let it steam for 10 minutes. Well, we've had a steady stream of escaping steam for 10 minutes. Now, the processing on this is going to be an hour and 15 minutes at 10 pounds of pressure. And the way you get this gauge to 10 pounds is with this weight gauge. It has numbers on it, 5, 10, and 15. Again, this one we want to do at 10 pounds. So the steam is coming out of there right now. So you want to be careful when you set this weight on there. You don't bring your hand down on top of that steam. You can do this with a pair of tongs. You can do it with your hand. You can do it however you want to do it, but just don't put your hand on top of that steam. And there's a hole under there at 10 pounds. Hear that? You set that on there, and it'll start building pressure, and this thing will start jiggling. And you want to get this to 10 pounds, and I'm going to try to point out what 10 pounds is. Let me get my knife, my pointer. On this gauge, you can see it's already rising. That's degrees on the outside, and this is pounds on the inside. You can see 0, 5, right there's 5, and right there's 10. We want to get that needle up to 10 pounds and hold steady. And that'll happen. This All-American canner is amazing. The gate, that, you know, just everything about this whole configuration is awesome. You can see that there's steam escaping right now. It's in still in liquid form. That's not a problem. It's gonna all dissipate. It's gonna come out of there. And we're gonna get this up to 10 pounds. Once we get it to exactly 10 pounds, we're gonna adjust the temperature down on the stove. And I know exactly what to do. This stove was my mom's canning stove for, you know, once she got away from all the using wood and coal and everything else. This stove was my mom's canning stove. I've actually rebuilt it a couple of times, and I'm gonna keep it forever. And I know exactly, because I grew up helping her do this stuff. And I just turn this thing down on medium, and that's a perfect timer. That's a perfect temperature on this stove. Turn it down to medium, and I'm good. Okay, this All-American canner is so precision made that it just reached 10 pounds and it's already starting to spit and it'll jiggle. Now what we do is just turn this down to medium. Jiggling now. I mean, this is a precision made piece of equipment right here, man. I mean, it's exactly 10 pounds and that is telling that gauge that it's at 10 pounds right now. And it's releasing to make sure that it maintains 10 pounds of pressure.
Now that's it, we gotta wait.
Now what we do, we got it at exactly 10. We got our, you know, we got our temperature turned down so that it'll maintain. So right now, I'm looking at my watch, 20 after 5. There's a lot of ways to do this. I'm gonna show you one cool way that I can shoot it. Some stoves have a timer, but back in the old days, they had no timers. They had no stickies. You had to just put a piece of duct tape on there. But what we do, we know right now that it's 20 after 5, 1 hour would be 20 after 6, and 1 hour and 15 minutes would be 25 to 7, or 6:35, whichever way you want to do it. So we'll put right on here, 6:35. And that way there's absolutely no way that I'm going to forget. And you put it on the label, not on the pot. Put it right on the label. And then no matter what I'm doing, I know that at 6:35, I need to come back and take that off. That is what you call a redneck way to set the timer on a canner. Well,
wow, it held at 10 for an hour.
6:35, it stayed right at 10, and right there, 6:35. Nowadays, especially these young bloods, they got these iPhones and what other kind of phones they got, guy?
Smartphones.
Smartphones, iPhones,
Apple Watch, iPads.
Yeah, I mean, I can't even believe.
I got all that stuff.
Yeah, I know. Guys got all that stuff. I got nothing.
You got a Post-it.
I got a Timex watch
and a Post-it.
and one of those. What's the name of my phone? The Raider.
A flip phone.
No, but what's it called?
Rumor.
I got a Rumor, man. All I do is text. Anyways, we gotta shut the heat off now and wait till this thing cools down. When it gets down to zero, we will take the weight off, leave that off for 2 minutes, and then we can open this thing. It's gonna take about 5 minutes for this thing to cool down, so. It's down to zero, but you gotta look really close at that gauge. There's a tine in there that actual needle sits on when it's down to zero. You gotta make sure it's all the way down to there. And then what you do is just take this weight off. And when I lift it up, usually, there you go. You can hear a little bit more escaping. So you gotta wait 2 minutes after you lift that off of there to make sure there's absolutely no more in there. Okay, we've waited 2 minutes. Now, you gotta be very, very careful, because this is still very warm. Just gotta be careful. Now, you can wait till this thing cools down to the touch, But there's something that you need to realize. You do not want to leave those jars of food in there like overnight with this lid on, because there's a vacuum created inside this thing. You don't want to leave it in there like that. So you open this the same way you closed it, crisscross from side to side. You take these off. Now I'm going to give you something that I think is a tip. I'm going to make sure you don't get burned. Now, when you release these down, this can't blow up because it's locked in. We locked it in. So when you get ready to open this thing, there's a couple of things to think about. You want to try to move it a little bit back and forth to make sure it's free before you try to make the turn. Turn it, wiggle it a little bit more, and open it with the lid to the back. Never open that with it coming up in your face. You see that steam coming up back there?
Yep.
You don't want that steam coming up in your face. It's still got that kind of temperature in those jars.
Wow.
So you can wait 10 minutes and let it cool down a little bit, and then you can lift those out. Now, when you put that jar lifter on there, can you see down in there? You don't want to lift that lid. You want that jar lifter to go past that and this part of the jar lifter to sit against your lid. So when you squeeze that, you lift that up. Be very careful. Set it on a smooth, flat surface and be very careful how you set that. And don't touch it again. You do not touch that thing. We like to leave it sitting for 12 to... Well, we like to leave it sitting for 15 hours to make sure. And then you can see that some of these lids are not sucked down right now. They will. They will seal.
They pop over time. Yeah.
They will pop over time. And if we...
You'll hear them.
Yeah, you could hear them popping. So we're going to set them over here really carefully. I got to tell you that I've had a lot of canners in my life. And, you know, and we've had them in our family forever. This All-American canner is the absolute best canner that I have ever used. And I love that metal to metal seal. And I love the safety factor that when you lock that thing down, you don't have to worry about it blowing up in your house. This thing is a high quality canner. And if you don't have a canner, or even if you do, I recommend that you get yourself one of these and you will not have any worries.